All right, everybody. I don't know if you can hear me, but thank you for coming. We're about to get started in a second, but before we do, we have a couple of words from our sponsors. So if you don't mind, give them a second of your attention. That would be great.
Hello. Hey. Hello. There we go. Okay. I'm Jonathan. I'm with Super. So I know like 98% of you guys. So I'm just going to be brief. We do home warranties very differently. How many people here are agents? Okay, so like half and half. Cool. So we do home warranties very differently than what's out there. If you do not know, connect with me. We only use 4- and 5-star contractors. We have maintenance included, and we're a tech company. So we truly are very different than what's out there. Much higher coverage limits and higher quality. So happy to support you guys. I know it's a competitive market, so we're here to support you guys as agents, as title attorneys, as settlement agents. Whatever you guys have, we're here to support you guys. So Jonathan was super. I'm going to stick around, and I'll pass it off to Andy.
Good morning. Hi, everyone. Annie Tech here with MBH. I'm the business development manager. And I have some team members here with me, so you guys can give a wave. We have Todd, Colleen, and Beverly back there. So my goal is to work with real estate agents and their clients to make sure they have seamless and stress-free experiences to the settlement table. And we're all about helping you grow and all about education. So with that being said, I have some opportunities for you guys to join. September 13th, we have Understanding Residential Virginia Contracts coming up. And then we also have a summer series with our very own MBH's Julie Turner. It's a 3-part series. The first one will be next Wednesday. I think it's the 23rd. And you're able to join. We're going to be going over Canva tools. So if you want to familiarize yourself with Canva, how to use that, please join us. We're right out there. We have a table full of swag. And if you have any questions or you have any classes that you want to see us teach, feel free to come by and talk to us. Thank you so much. Oh, here's Sherry.
Hello. I'm Sherry Skinner. I'm the client services manager with Interstate Moving and Storage. I've never seen so many jackets and ties at a realtor class. Are you?
The lawyers.
Yeah, I know. Got it. We're a full-service moving company. Our headquarters are in Springfield, Virginia. We also have facilities with storage and dispatch in Sterling, Virginia, and Landover, Maryland, so we can handle your clients moving within the area, into the area, out of the area. We also continue to have our declutter special. I have flyers out at my table about that. If you need to get a house decluttered before you have to put it on the market of the items they want to move to the next house, but you would like it out. I forgot to mention, this year's our 80-year anniversary, yay, in business. And we're still run by the same family here in Northern Virginia. And we did join the North American fleet, so we actually have more capacity all over the United States with being part of that fleet. But the Morris set's still on our company here, and they're still running it, third generation. Our other special on the flyer that I have out there, you can pick up, is 1 free month of storage. If someone can't move directly from house A to B for some reason, or if they're getting a house built, the first month of storage would be free. If they need some time while their stuff is in storage while that's being built, or if they just need a truck hold because maybe they have to get out of a house, close on a house, and then they get the keys to the new house. We will not charge them additional for that truck hold time, so they just pay for the move. So that's it. Have a good class. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Keith Barrett. I'm the founder of Vesta Settlements. I am a former recovering member of the NVAR Forms Committee. I'm almost there. And I currently serve as chairman of the Attorney Roundtable. And we are pleased this afternoon to bring to you some programming today on the topic of RESPA.
I'll call you back.
I have the privilege of introducing our guest this morning. And joining us are Jay Varon and Jennifer Keas. They are both partners with the law firm of Foley and Lardner, a large national and international law firm. They are both officed in the Washington, D.C. office. Jay and Jen are here today to speak about RESPA. I'll be very brief to give them as much time as possible to address you. But they are both highly experienced, highly sought after trial attorneys and counselors, both of whom have a niche area in defending and counseling real estate clients, including real estate brokers, MLSs, mortgage brokers, lenders, mortgage, title, home warranty, and title agents with respect to various areas of the law, consumer finance, fair lending, UDAP, but for today, and one of their highly specialized areas is that of RESPA. And so please join me in welcoming them and thanking them for giving up their time today to present to you. Jay and Jen, have at it.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for the introduction. All right, so let me give you a little bit of an overview of what we're going to do today, but I'll just say that, you know, RESPA really is a pretty specialized area. I would say there are a lot of people in the country who know a little bit about RESPA, and only very few people in the country who know a lot about RESPA, and it's because it really is just sort of a difficult, tricky area. So we're going to go over kind of a refresher on the basics for you today, and then do a little bit more of a deep dive into the RESPA exemptions, which are sort of the areas where there's a little bit more wiggle room to set up arrangements and to work with referral partners in a compliant way. We certainly don't expect you to memorize every detail of what we're going to talk about today, but in our practice and in our experience, it's pretty helpful to sort of get these kind of refreshers on a regular basis if you're not a, you know, full-time RESPA lawyer, just so that you have the sensitivity to sort of know when you should go to someone who's a specialist and ask a question and kind of what the sensitive areas are and what the guidelines and principles are. So that's our goal today. And as we go, if you have any questions, please feel free to put your hand up, because we generally find that if someone has a question about something, everyone else is interested to hear the answer. Okay. So, you know, I think you guys are familiar with the core prohibition in RESPA Section 8, or at least you should be. It's generally an anti-referral fee statute. It's a federal law, and it basically provides that you can't pay for the referral of business, except for in certain special situations. And it's a pretty unique law, right? There are not a lot of laws in the country, except for maybe the healthcare industry, where you can't pay to acquire business. Those of you in the room who are real estate agents or who run title or escrow companies know this very well, but it really does make the way you acquire business and customers a little bit special and unique. Okay, so that core prohibition is basically coming from this language right out of the statute. It's been on the books for over 40 years, and it provides that no person shall give and no person shall accept anything of value pursuant to an agreement or understanding that they'll refer settlement service business. And the key thing about all of that is that there are elements to it. And essentially, Congress and the regulator have defined each one about as broadly as they possibly could. And the reason is that they wanted to capture as much creativity and conduct as they possibly could, right? So when the statute says, you know, thing of value, we kind of interpret that, and regulators do as well, is almost anything that you would keep rather than throw away. So there's no kind of de minimis exemption. It's not like, oh, a $25 gift card doesn't count. It's anything of value. So that's very broadly interpreted. And it can mean things like the chance to win a prize or extra frequent flyer miles. It's very broadly defined. And you can kind of see here, we won't get into every single one in detail, but each of these is very broadly defined, right? An agreement or understanding about referrals doesn't have to be a contract, doesn't have to be written down. It can basically be almost like a nod, a wink. Regulators often just infer it from the circumstances. They say, you're getting this benefit, you're sending the business, there's an agreement. So that's very broadly defined as well. Settlement services, I think sometimes people don't realize how broadly that one can be defined. You all know some of the traditional ones, right? Real estate brokerage, mortgage, escrow, all of that. But Regulation X also essentially defines it as anything that's provided in connection with the closing on a federally related mortgage loan, which is basically most financed residential real estate closings, for which the consumer is going to pay a charge in whole or in part. And that broad definition can capture some new innovative things. So our rule of thumb that we generally point out is if it's being charged to a client on the closing disclosure or the CD, you need to think a little bit more closely about whether it's a settlement service. federally related mortgage loan. That's sort of the hook for whether RESPA Section 8 applies, but it's essentially going to cover most financed residential real estate transactions. And of course, probably most importantly for your purposes, referral is also very broadly defined, right? It includes a whole host of conduct, can be electronic, on the phone, in writing, marketing material, anything that's really going to affirmatively influence that customer to pick the provider you're telling them about.
So I'm going to talk to you about a twin provision. What Jen just talked about is in Section 8A of RESPA, and this piece is called Section 8B. It's kind of lost some of its allure over time, but just like RESPA says, no person can give and accept a thing of value pursuant to a referral agreement. This one says no person shall give and no person shall accept any portion, split, or percentage of a settlement charge without doing some service. And so at one time, the HUD, other regulators, and certainly the private class actions bar tried to use this provision to attack excessive pricing. They thought if pricing was too high on something, well then there's some kind of split going on and it's actionable. The Supreme Court put an end to that in this case called Freeman v. Quicken Loans, in which we actually wrote an amicus brief advocating for that position. And now it's very clear that in order to violate this provision, there actually has to be a settlement charge, not just money, but like a title search, a title commission, something, and you split it with somebody else who does no service. And just to give you an idea of what no service can mean, one of the classic cases was about Chase Manhattan Bank had a situation where they would refer everybody to a particular courier, and they'd pass that charge on to the customer, and they'd mark it up. And the idea was, well, you're splitting the courier charge with the courier, and you're taking an extra piece, and you really didn't do any service for it. And they defended and said, yes, we did. We did a service. We arranged for it. We made a phone call for it. We put it in the envelope for them. That's a service. And the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals said, that's a service. That's no that's not no service. So as a result, this particular provision is not used very often, but it is occasionally used when there literally is a split of the actual fee that's involved. One thing that Jen didn't mention that you may be on some of your minds because you're realtors is none of this applies to the splitting of real estate commissions among or between real estate agents and real estate brokers.
You'll see that when we talk about the exemption.
Because there's a specific exemption for it. But other than that, if you are splitting a charge, the charge with somebody, they need to be doing something. Not much, but something.
Not much under 8B.
Right. It would
still be an 8A problem if they're not doing much.
Right.
Okay, so just to kind of boil it down, we're talking about Section 8A, the kinds of things that are generally prohibited under the statute. You guys obviously know this, a broker, an agent, taking money for each customer that it sends to a settlement service provider, like a home warranty provider or lender or a settlement company. And again, that doesn't have to be money. It can be anything of value. It's important to remember that liability for that kind of violation goes both ways, right? Sometimes people have the misnomer that because the mortgage folks that are often named in the enforcement actions or the title companies that, you know, it doesn't apply equally to real estate. It does. If you give or accept a thing of value, either one of you or both of you could be held completely liable for the whole violation. Inherent in this RESPA definition of a settlement service and in a referral is that the consumer has to pay some charge. So some RESPA lawyers, us included, have kind of successfully defended in some situations where it was a service that was never charged to the consumer. And a good example of that has to do with, we've seen cases alleging that there was a RESPA kickback involving MLS fees or a technology fee, something that was really actually just a business-to-business fee that was never passed on to the consumer. and we think that really kind of falls outside the definition of a referral and a settlement service. But again, I go back to what I said to you before. In general, if it's being charged to the consumer on the closing disclosure, we need to probably assume that RESPA is going to apply to it. Preferred provider arrangements, we'll highlight some of the cases or enforcement actions that have had these. But some of you may kind of scratch your heads a little bit and say, really, RESPA prohibits preferred providers? Like, I've seen preferred provider, you know, advertising or relationships all over the place. And the key here is that, you know, RESPA doesn't prohibit referrals. You can have a preferred provider. You can recommend someone to your customers as a preferred provider all day long, but not if they're paying you to do that, right? And that goes back to that very broad RESPA definition of a referral. There is room, and we'll talk about this a little bit, to provide advertising services. Some of you all may engage in co-marketing, for example, with a lender or something like that. And there's room to do that. But what gets folks into trouble is if they're getting paid to actually endorse someone. If, you know, if a lender came in and said, I want to be your preferred provider, I want to be on your agent website, and I want you to say that, you know, this ABC lender is your preferred provider, and I'm going to pay you to do that, that would probably be a RESPA violation, and a pretty simple and obvious one, because they're paying you to essentially recommend them, and that's referral activity. So, you know, getting paid to designate someone as a preferred provider is a pretty straightforward RESPA problem. Same thing with paid endorsements. That's why you've seen maybe some older CFPB enforcement actions, for example, where someone got dinged for getting paid to be a salesperson, go around and recommend a particular title company. That's not gonna be okay unless you are eligible for an exemption. And things like contests where, you know, every time you refer a customer, you get a chance to win a prize. Sometimes we still see things like that. We see them on social media, for example. And not only is that a bad idea, but it's an extra bad idea because it's very publicly visible. So I would definitely steer away from something like that.
Just to give you one example on the contest side that illustrates a couple of these points,
yeah.
There was one situation where a brokerage said to all its agents, all you have to do is make one referral to a mortgage company or mortgage company, and you get put in a lottery, and the prize you win is you get to park closest to the entrance. And that was viewed as a thing of value because, in fact, somebody wanted that. Probably could have, you know, they could have parked right next to it, no problem. And the contest was, you know, was a simple one. All you had to do was make one referral. But that's the kind of thing that can get you in trouble.
Yep.
All right, I'm going to start with the exemptions for a second. So I jumped the gun a little bit and told you about the what's called a cooperative brokerage exemption, which is why agents can refer outbound traffic to another real estate agent and take a referral fee back. It's why agents can refer business to their real estate broker, and the real estate broker gives them 80% of the commission if they're good and keeps 20% for itself. Normally, all of that would be subject to RESPA, but the National Association of Realtors realized that that would put a death knell on real estate brokerage, and so they got an exemption for it.
That's also the exemption, for example, that Zillow utilized when it's paying referral fee arrangements with real estate licensees.
But it doesn't apply outside the real estate brokerage area. So you can't say, I'm going to refer you to a mortgage broker, and I'm a real estate agent, so you can pay me. That won't work. The second exemption is called the affiliated business arrangement exemption. And it's the exemption that permits different settlement service providers to have ownership interests in other settlement service providers, refer business to them, and have their share of the profits paid back to them that's commensurate with what their ownership interest is. So if ABC Brokerage wants to invest in a title company and buys a 10% interest for fair value, they can refer business to that title company. They have to do a couple of other things that we'll talk about. But if they do those things and then the title company declares a $1,000 dividend and their ownership interest is 10%, it's lawful for them to get $100 back Whereas if they didn't have an ownership interest and they just said, we sent you 10 deals, we want $100, that would be a violation. The third exemption is really basic to how everybody in the real estate service business does business. We call it the for services rendered exception. And what it means is that you can refer business to somebody. If you're a mortgage broker, you can refer business to a lender. If you're a title agent, you can refer business to a title underwriter. And you can get paid for the value of the service you may have used other than the referral. So in a mortgage contest, for example, the theory is that the mortgage broker takes a loan application, it gathers all the relevant mortgage information, puts it in a package, and pushes it back to the lender. So the lender didn't have to do that. And the lender can therefore pay the fair value of what those services are worth, even though the lender, the mortgage broker, is making a referral to the lender at the same time. If somebody pays too much, you know, if the going rate for what I just described is a basis point, or 100 basis points, 1 point, and somebody gets 3 points for it, the regulators are likely to say, two of those points have to be for the referral, because nobody would pay 1 point for that, and that would be a problem. So it has to be fair value. And that's also this for services rendered exemption. Jen mentioned that there are these advertising agreements and marketing agreements. That's the theory there too, that even though in an advertising arrangement, it's likely that if brokerage XYZ has an advertising arrangement with ABC lender, they're going to market that lender, they're going to advertise the lender, they're not going to endorse them, but they're going to permit the lender to go into their real estate magazines and write an article, they're going to put ads in it, and that costs money. And if the money that's paid equals to the fair value of the ad, then that's compliant. If too much money is paid, it's going to be a problem. And so fair market value principles are really critical to those kinds of exemptions. You can't pay too much to the party that's making a referral. I think you're going to take it from here.
Yep. So there are other exemptions that are pretty unique and interesting. One of them, and this is very common sense, this didn't come out in the statute, but it's promulgated in the RESPA regulation, basically just recognizes that providers in the industry need to have a little bit of room to sort of entertain their referral sources and norm and promote themselves reasonably like any other business person. There are some sort of parameters around that, though, because I think the regulator appropriately realized that this could be misused and used to circumvent the kickback prohibition if you don't essentially keep it very cool. And the way you have to keep it cool, number one, is when you're, you know, entertaining a referral source or a potential referral source or promoting yourself, you can't condition that on the referral of business, right? So one example of, you know, entertaining someone, say, you know, hey, let's go out, you know, for happy hour, but I'm only going to invite the people who are willing to send me a deal in the next month. That's obviously runs afoul of that very common sense principle. And you also can't use it to defray the business expenses of the people that you're working with, right? So you can't, for example, say that you're going to prepare a bunch of, if you're a lender, you can't prepare a bunch of marketing material for a particular realtors and give it to them for free and say, you know, this is just part of my effort to promote myself. Here, use this, and you can send out all these free postcards. That would be a problem because you're not just sort of getting in front of them and letting them know you're a great lender, but you're doing it in a way that defrays business expenses they would otherwise incur. And some of the enforcement actions we'll highlight for you today are instances where people ran into that. Another one, and I think Jay and I have both over the years sort of thought that this one is one that the regulators should view differently, but they to date they haven't, is that, you know, folks can't defray continuing education for realtors, right? So you could go to something that's just a lunch and learn and not get any CE for it, and as long as it's, you know, normal and reasonable and they're just using it to feature, you know, trends in the lending market and promote themselves, that's fine. But as soon as you get free CE credit for it, it's not okay. You have to pay something for the CE credit that you're getting. And the theory behind that is that, you know, it's defraying a business expense that the realtor would otherwise have. I don't know that I necessarily agree with that, but that's how regulators have looked at it to date. There's also another one, and this rules out probably most real estate agents who are typically independent contractors, but there's a lot of room for a provider, including someone like a real estate broker, to pay its own bona fide employees for their referral activity. So this is how, for example, a real estate brokerage can bonus its managers who are employees for capture rate if, you know, they have good numbers on their affiliated title. They're doing that because it's a specific RESPA exemption. But again, it doesn't apply to folks who have independent contractor status, which makes that generally an inapplicable exemption for real estate agents. Yeah, question.
That brings up an interesting point. And I just want to make sure I'm clear on that.
Yeah.
Because we live in a world now which has wholly owned subsidiary title companies owned by a mortgage company and wholly owned subsidiary title companies owned by a real estate brokerage. So in that specific one that you just mentioned, for example, if a real estate brokerage told its agents that based upon the amount of referrals to our wholly owned subsidiary, you can have this percentage commission split. But if you were to refer more, you get a higher commission split. Is that allowable under that exemption?
No, it's not. And the reason is that this exemption really only applies to employees, right? So you could make that sort of offer to employee managers, someone who's a W-2 employee. They aren't going to be the ones typically out there working with buyers and sellers. They're going to be in a managerial role, sort of out in the office talking about title. What can we do to make things better? Won't you consider using our wholly owned title? They're great. Give them a shot. You know, how come you didn't make any referrals last month? That's the kind of thing a manager is going to be doing. You can take that into account in bonusing that manager. What you can't do is take it into account in giving anything of value to an independent contractor agent. And that would include considering something like, I'll put you on a higher split, but you've got to support the affiliate, because that would be a thing of value and essentially be offered as part of an agreement or understanding that they're going to refer to title.
But just to be clear, a mortgage, a bank that had a relationship with a title company could bonus its managers, its bank tellers, its loan officers, as long as they were all employees, they could all be told, if you send somebody to the title company, we will pay you X, because there it's the employer and employees who are both managers and more in kind of all in line with the consumer, but that would be okay in that instance.
But your hypothetical about sort of the corporate relationships brings up another aspect to this exemption that folks sometimes run into trouble with, and that is that under this exemption, it really has to be the employee paying its own employer, paying its own employee for the activity. So you couldn't have the brokerage sort of bonusing its managers for title capture, but then having the title company pay back all those bonuses, right? Because that's a problem. It's not the employer paying its own employee, it's the title company essentially making a payment to brokerage. So that would be a problem.
And the reason they have this is basically the kind of theory that an employer is kind of this entity. It only works through its employees. It ought to be able to have the employees do what the employer wants. Notwithstanding that, there was a big movement in the late 80s to get rid of this exemption. They almost got rid of it, and Congress got lobbied, and they took it back. And so the exemption still exists, and it's used a lot.
We've highlighted a series of other exemptions. Some of them aren't particularly glamorous and are very rarely used. There's some exemptions for what counts as a RESPA-covered loan, basically. Those are very few and far between. Most financed residential real estate transactions are going to be covered by RESPA. These are just a couple of very discrete exemptions. A bigger one is the secondary market exemption, and that's basically once a loan has closed, it's over and done with. As you all probably, most of you know, loans are then often resold in the secondary market to investors. That activity, which is truly in the secondary market, is not covered by RESPA. But that exemption doesn't cover mortgage broker transactions. Mortgage broker transactions are, you know, before that point, so they're fully subject to RESPA. A more interesting one is at the bottom here as number 9, and that's consumer rebates. And this is sort of an informally recognized exemption, but it's pretty well established under RESPA. State law sometimes can present a conflict. But at least on the federal level, it's generally viewed that if you offer things of value to consumers to use a particular provider, that's okay. That doesn't count as sort of a thing of value for the referral of business. And the idea really is that the consumer's not referring themselves, so RESPA doesn't really apply. So that's why you see things like, you know, someone's told that they can get a closing cost credit if they use a particular, you know, settlement company, or builders will often offer, you know, a package upgrade or a closing cost credit to folks who will use their affiliated mortgage company. That's coming from this principle here. We'd be remiss if we didn't kind of talk about the scarier aspects of RESPA, and this is why it's so important to sort of be cautious and wary of this statute. This is really a federal law with a lot of teeth. I think you guys probably already know this, but I'll just run down the parade of horribles because this is a law you really care about getting wrong. We mentioned a little bit that there's joint and several liability, and basically what that means is that if there's, you know, two parties to a RESPA violation, either one of them can be fully liable for the entire violation. So the regulator or the plaintiff could go after either one it chooses and try to get the whole thing from them, which can be fairly daunting. There's a private right of action that doesn't apply to every federal prohibition, but that does apply here, which means that an individual consumer who's done business with you or with the other provider can sue you as long as they do so on time and can meet sort of the minimum requirements of a lawsuit. They can sue you. The counterpart is that generally they only have 1 year to do that, so RESPA does have a pretty tight time limit for private causes of action. But there's real exposure available, right? So RESPA provides in a private right of action for treble damages, which means three times your damages. And usually that's interpreted as three times the value of the settlement service involved in the violation, plus attorney's fees for their lawyer. And because of those features, RESPA private actions are often brought as putative class actions, which means, you know, they're not just representing one consumer, but they're saying, you know, everybody who did business under these circumstances is entitled to their money back. And even if you're only looking at 1 year, that very quickly can get into the millions or even tens of millions of dollars when you look at treble damages. You know, we've been involved in cases where, you know, it was a title fee at issue, and those were, you know, pretty big fees, and you treble them, and you look at everybody who was involved in the proposed class, and very quickly it can be, you know, tens of millions of dollars. There's also government enforcement. And you guys probably are aware that the federal agency that oversees RESPA is the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, or the CFPB. That's the watchdog agency that took over a lot of the consumer financial statutes, including RESPA, in 2011. And the CFPB not only enforces RESPA, but it shares enforcement of RESPA with state attorneys general. So the Bureau could bring an action, it could investigate, or a state attorney general could. And there are some states that are particularly active in that. I don't think Virginia is historically one of them, but Maryland has been a big area. You might have heard of, for example, the genuine title action some years ago that was pretty big. The Maryland AG participated in that. And the thing to be wary of on the government enforcement side is not only is there a longer statute of limitations, so they can look back, you know, 3 years, but the penalties involved are massive. There's a civil money penalty framework that applies in addition to RESPA's penalties, which, as we talked about, are the treble damages. But the civil money penalty structure is very significant, and it essentially gives the CFPB a ton of leverage, right? So there's three different tiers. One is, you know, a penalty they can apply every day a violation existed for any violation. The next level is if it was a knowing violation. And the third worst level is if it was a willful violation. And each one gets more and more. So the minimum for any violation is over $6,000 a day. Then it goes to over $34,000 a day for a knowing violation, and over $1 million a day for a willful violation. So essentially, it just basically means that they can posit even a low-level theory, and under that structure, you're very quickly looking at millions of dollars of exposure, even just for a year. And they have a lot of leeway to investigate you, too. So even if you have a good story to tell, and you have good defenses, and you've done what you did thoughtfully, and you think you can ultimately convince them, The investigatory process in and of itself can be painful, lengthy, and expensive.
So I'm going to talk about this affiliated business exemption for just another minute. It's again, it's the one that's used when settlement service providers have ownership interests in other settlement service providers, or even real estate agents, consumers, anybody. So this is a pretty solid exemption. I mean, you can follow the rules and do this, and that's why there are all these affiliated business arrangements. What you have to do is, if you have one of these and you work for somebody or you have the ownership interest in the company, you have to disclose it. And there's a affiliated business disclosure form that's right in the Federal Register. It's not very complicated. It talks about that the fact that you have this business relationship. It asks you to describe it. It tells the consumer that they don't have to accept the referral. They can shop around and make sure they're happy. And then it indicates that if they do accept the referral, they should know that the person making it and the people that are affiliated with them and work for them may benefit from it. So we have an axe to grind here, is basically the message. And if you give that disclosure, you're in good shape for one requirement. Then the second requirement, as I mentioned earlier, is you can't force the people to accept the referral. And then you can only get the return on ownership that you've invested. So my 10% example before is what we're talking about there. Mm-hmm. And then there's just one other thing that HUD and the CFPB put on top of what Congress did. And they were concerned that people were going to form these arrangements, joint ventures or affiliated business arrangements, but they weren't going to be real. And the classic example was going to be a real estate agent goes to a lender and says, you know, look, I've been giving you business for like all year and I've sent you 20 deals. I want, you know, you to give me 50% of your profits. And the lender says, well, I wish I could, but, you know, that'd be a clear RESPA violation. I can't do that. And the real estate broker goes, well, you know what? Why don't we form an affiliated business arrangement? Let's go into partnership. I have 50, we're going to call this the green and yellow partnership. And you have green as 50%, and I have yellow and 50%, and we're going to do the same business. And now I'm entitled to 50% of your profits. And the regulators go, well, what's different in that situation from the one that we just had? And the answer is nothing. So they've devised this guidelines that said, you can't just be an affiliated business arrangement or a joint venture in name only. You have to have capital. You have to have a business. You have to have employees that work for that business. Those employees have to do what the business is set up for. So if you're a title agency, you have to have employees that are actually doing core title services. And you have to, you know, have a phone number and a website, and you have to look and feel like you're a business, not some mythical partnership. And then there are about six other factors that none of which are formulaic. Somebody looks at it and says, is this a sham or is this not a sham? And if it's a sham, they won't give you the affiliated business exemption. So, you know, like I say, it's not formulaic, but the RESPA lawyers, and certainly Jen and I, have done enough of these that we know what factors are important and what factors aren't, and we counsel our clients to make sure they stay on this side of the line. But there's a lot of gray area in this, and sometimes lawyers don't agree exactly on what those factors are. And so there are cases in which people challenge, regulators and the plaintiff's class action bar, challenge affiliated business arrangements as not being genuine. And we'll talk about one or two of those as we go forward. In fact, right here. this Minter case is a case that Jen and I tried together with one or two other firms. That was a big joint venture between one of the biggest mid-Atlantic real estate brokers in the country and one of the biggest national lenders in the country that formed a lending joint venture together. And the plaintiffs attacked it as sham. And it was done at a time where there were a lot of smaller title joint ventures being attacked as sham, and they probably were, and all of those settled. And the judge that we got was familiar with the title ones and just figured that ours was of the same ilk. And so we made all these motions. We tried to appear before him. He wouldn't give us the time of day.
7 years later, we were in trial.
Right. we had a four-week trial in which we pretty convincingly showed why we weren't a sham. But it was a shame because we spent a lot of money doing it. And that's one of the things that we counsel about a lot. Even when you win, as somebody who's been investigated, you lose because you've had to spend so much time and effort and money in defending yourself. So not only do you want your agreements to be compliant and legal, you want them to be so clean that when somebody looks at them, they're not even going to want to go any
farther.
They should
look good. They should smell good. Yeah,
exactly.
That's what we try to do.
Exactly.
This list is just ones that you would see if you Googled them. There'd be headlines. They were tried. They were, you know, you could see. There's lots more that get looked at and may, you know, eventually go away at the government enforcement level. But there was time and pain and money and distraction for everybody involved and stress while they were at least being investigated.
So we would go through all of these. The Carter one is somewhat interesting because it actually adjudicated another private action that tried to declare a joint venture sham under the guidelines that HUD and the CFPB had issued. And this Court of Appeals that has jurisdiction over, I think, Kentucky, Tennessee, Michigan, and Ohio, said that these guidelines were so incomprehensible that they were unconstitutional and he wasn't going to enforce them. And so those people won their joint venture case, not because they necessarily met the factors, but because the court said, these are terrible. But it's the only court that did that. And in everywhere else but those four states, these guidelines are still enforced.
And even there, the CFPB could apply them in an agency action, so.
In an agency action or even in a federal court action in which you don't mention the guidelines, but they kind of use the same concepts to suggest that there's too much monkey business going on, and they do that once in a while. I don't think we need to talk about the others, but there are a lot of high-profile cases. We've done at least half of those, but there are, you know, it's a serious business when that's why we're here.
So we wanted to at least mention advertising services agreements. I think we touched on these when we talked about the for services rendered exemption, because as we said before, there is room under RESPA to get paid for, you know, providing ad exposure and advertising services to someone, even if they are someone that you refer business to, right? Normally you'd think, well, you can't get paid by someone you send business to. Well, you can if you are actually providing real advertising services, not just referrals, but advertising services, and you're getting paid no more than the fair market value of them. And that's the entire premise behind an advertising services agreement or an ASA. These used to kind of be referred to more colloquially as marketing services agreements or MSAs. I think the nomenclature has gotten away from that a little bit just to kind of emphasize that you're not really doing sales or marketing for that provider, you're helping them advertise. And one of the things we do a lot, we answer questions for folks about, you know, how do you know when it might be right for you to just do an ASA or to just do co-marketing versus consider a joint venture with a prospective partner. There are a lot of considerations that go into that analysis. And then if you want to get into an ASA, you know, what can we get paid for? How do we assess fair market value? What are the pitfalls? There can be some real pitfalls to an ASA. If you keep it simple and are really sure about the valuation, they're generally pretty safe. On the other hand, you're never going to get paid based on volume. It's not at all like a joint venture where you can get returns on ownership, and the more the JV makes, the more you make as an owner. If you do an ASA properly, you're really only going to get a fixed fee payment for the value, or maybe even a little less than the value of the ad exposure that you're providing, and it's not going to go up if it's very successful. There are some principles that come into play with an ASA from a 2010 CFPB, or at least at the time it was a HUD home warranty rule that kind of took a look at home warranty advertising agreements, but is generally considered to apply at large to the industry. And it has things like, you know, you shouldn't get paid to have an exclusive arrangement for someone, so you don't want to get paid to sort of promise that they're the only lender you're ever going to advertise and things like that. But it's generally consistent for the most part with the principles that I was just describing, that you have to get paid for actual services that are compensable under RESPA, not referrals, and you have to be mindful of your valuation principles. The CFPB in 2015, this is right around the time of the PHH case and some other sort of questionable CFPB activities, threw a lot of confusion into the ASA space when it issued a 2015 compliance bulletin that gave a lot of contrary and confusing advice. That was subsequently rescinded, so we don't consider that, we didn't consider it at the time to be particularly helpful, but now it's been rescinded completely. So the CFPB hasn't really given a lot of good, clear guidance about how advertising services agreements work. I think a lot of people get good advice on that from going to workshops and listening to talks and things like this, and hopefully if you're getting involved in especially a bigger advertising agreement, getting some, you know, compliance advice along the way. But there are little bits to glean from things like CFPB consent order. Sometimes the Bureau will bring an action and it'll at least describe in general terms what it believed to be problematic, and Prospect was one of those situations. And it was also a rare instance where the Bureau settled RESPA Section 8 allegations, not only against a lender, but against some of the real estate brokers, and in this case it was hundreds of them that were alleged to have, you know, advertising and other agreements with this lender. The Bureau actually settled at least some of those charges with a couple of the real estate brokers to kind of send a message that, you know, both parties can be on the hook for something like that. And improper advertising agreements were one of the theories in that.
The real problem was it was supposed to be an advertising agreement, but the people on the brokerage side were doing way more than advertising. They were really talking up Prospect as a lender, and, you know, kind of issuing conditions about how you had to use Prospect or put it in your listing if you, you know, wanted to go forward. And so it was
a pretty
easy case.
Prequels and things like that.
Yeah.
This is just to kind of continue to highlight that there's all sorts of actions that have alleged improper behavior. Not all of this has to do with advertising services agreements, but in each of these, and these are really only allegations, but alleging that, you know, you were getting paid too much, you were getting paid based on the referral volume, or your referral source wasn't just paying you for marketing, but it was defraying your business expenses, or funneling the referral fees through a shell company. Each of these had allegations along those lines.
Except for Bear, which we won.
Well, it didn't have the allegations.
Not because we proved that the marketing agreement was 100% kosher, but because Jen took an amazing deposition of the plaintiffs and got them to concede that they weren't hurt in the least, and that they couldn't have cared less which title company they were referred to, and that pretty much won the case.
Oftentimes, the plaintiffs, when you ask them, don't actually care that they were referred. So we talked about co-advertising a little bit. This is often kind of a lower level, a little bit more informal maybe than an advertising services agreement, because rather than, you know, a years-long contract with bigger monthly fees and a whole array of services, co-marketing is essentially that you and someone that you may send business to or get business from are going to advertise together. And that's generally fine as long as the party that's in a position to get the referrals isn't paying too much for that ad. That's the general principle, right? Because if they are, that's generally going to be viewed as a disguised kickback. The only reason they're paying for more than, you know, let's say the ad features each of them 50-50, but it's a real estate agent and a loan officer, and the loan officer's paying 80% of the ad, any regulator worth the salt is going to assume that extra 30% is just for any volume of referrals that they're getting from that agent. And so you want to be wary of that kind of thing. You also want to be wary of any sort of platform or arrangement that builds in, you know, the ability to get too many of your costs for the ad covered if you're the one in a position to make referrals. Just a very quick word about social media and online activity. It's just that all these same principles generally apply online. You can't assume that just because you're online, nobody's looking. In fact, it might be much easier to find and detect. So I see all sorts of things online about, like, you know, you want to be careful about, you know, endorsing somebody online or liking them or retweeting them or promoting them. It's fine if you want to just do that for free, but if they're paying you, you really need to consider, geez, it's just the same as if, you know, I was out there talking them up to people in person. It probably is. So you need to be mindful of that. You need to be careful about, you know, thanks so much for the referral lunches or gift cards and all sorts of things like that, because RESPA still applies in the online environment and sometimes potentially even more so. And we've also highlighted that, you know, online and social media and things like that, there can be other risks that kind of go along with some of this RESPA risk, things like, you know, fair housing, fair lending risk. States can have particular state laws on raffles. There can be state anti-inducement or anti-rebate laws. So you really want to be careful when you're doing something for the public. You want to say a quick word about leads? I know we're almost at time.
Sure. So I don't know. I assume some of you have heard about purchasing leads. And the question is, what's the difference between a lead and a referral? A lead is kind of sending cold contact information, like you have an open house and 20 people come through and you say to a lender, I'm gonna send you the name, email, and phone number of every person that came through this open house. You're gonna pay me $15 a person. You can go solicit them. That's not a referral, because for one thing, the consumer doesn't even know that it's happening, so you couldn't influence their behavior. You're just giving information to somebody else who will then solicit it. And that is viewed as compliant because it's not a referral. The problem is that a lot of people that buy leads don't want it to be cold. They want it to be warmed up or even hot. And when they warm it up and heat it, it goes from being a cold lead to a warm referral. In other words, well, just tell them to expect my call, right? So they know who I am. No, that's a referral. Well, tell them that, how about if I tell them I got their name from you? No, that's a warm referral as well.
You can do all that for
free. Yeah, you can do it all for free, but you can't do it for money. But nevertheless, there are very successful lead sharing businesses a lot of them do it properly. They do the cold thing, and as a result, somebody actually does know. I mean, you know, small companies probably don't do this as effectively as big people with call centers who get a list of 1,000 people, and then you start getting these obnoxious phone calls. I understand you're in the business to buy a house. Are you interested in XYZ mortgage? That's kind of the solicitation that comes from buying a lead. Mm-hmm. So just keep in mind the difference between a cold lead and a warm referral.
Oh, and so these are just a little bit more gloss on that promotion and entertainment exemption that I talked about before. You can't condition it on the referral of business. We talked about that, not defraying business expenses. Some more practical kind of considerations that Jay and I always recommend is, you know, you need to make sure that if you're calling something business entertainment or sponsorship, it really ought to provide that person who's paying for it a meaningful opportunity to feature and promote themselves, right? So you don't want to just pay to be a sponsor and then you're not there, none of your folks are there, you just paid to have, you know, that designation. You really want it to actually expose you. It shouldn't be too lavish, right? So you can take somebody to a ball game. Do you want to take them to, like, the actual Super Bowl, the World Series? Probably not. That's going to be looked at as askance. That's why, you know, we say it really needs to be normal activity. And obviously you want to be careful about tainting it with the way you describe it, right? We've actually seen instances, for example, where a state regulator is looking through reimbursements of a mortgage company or a loan officer, and they're seeing things like reimbursements for referral lunches or thank you lunches. That's really unnecessary and unhelpful if you're being examined. So obviously being careful to protect the way you describe it is important too.
I think we've covered virtually everything except maybe the incentives and
maybe just a quick word about transaction management systems. You know, it's an innovative industry. Things change all the time. You see all sorts of new innovators out there like Qualia or Lone Wolf. you know, for the most part, there's no reason to think that just because something is software that there's a problem, but there's also, you know, it's important to be cautious about new things, right? And we put transaction point up on this slide just to highlight that this was an instance where, in contrast to something like Qualia or Lone Wolf, which we generally understand to be perfectly reasonable back office software things that are used by businesses and working with other businesses, transaction point was structured a little bit differently, and it drew heat and RESPA sensitivity because it was an opportunity for referral sources to sort of get paid for working with customers and selecting other providers on a drop-down list. So essentially, if it's, you know, you're just calling it software, a transaction management system, but it's functioning in a way that RESPA would otherwise prohibit, it's an area where you should look a little bit more closely.
The difference is on the good systems, the broker chooses who they want to do business with and puts them on the system, but they don't get paid for doing that.
Right.
In the bad system, the broker has an incentive to put people on the system that they want, but in either directly or indirectly, gets money for getting them business that the transaction system will send them. So you just gotta be careful.
So just on this last slide, we've highlighted a few do's and don'ts from the things we talked about today. I don't think anything here would be a surprise to you if you've been paying attention, but, you know, don't accept anything of value. We give a whole laundry list of examples for settlement service referrals. Obviously, make sure that folks work to earn your business. It's perfectly fine to have someone that you prefer and recommend. We hear all the time people thinking they have to give three names. It's actually not true. You can give one if there's one you like. You can give referrals based on who you like, who's accountable to you. You just can't do it because they're incenting you. If you do have arrangements with referral sources, make sure you're watching that valuation issue and making sure you're getting paid properly. And obviously, seek RESPA advice if you're getting into anything more serious or considering doing so, something like, you know, a bigger advertising services agreement or even a joint venture. Those are trickier areas.
And we don't have a lot of time for questions, but we'll take one or two if you have.
Yeah. Hi, thank you for being here today. There's one question that's always been on my mind, and it depends who you talk to. If a client refers you business, can you send them a thank you gift?
Yeah, not, we hear that question a lot.
I mean, not in advance, I'm not saying right.
So technically, no, there's no exemption under RESPA for, you know, customers who send you basically what are RESPA-covered referrals. There's no sort of minimum thing where a gift card, now, are you likely to be necessarily detected for doing it? It's probably on the lower end, but the safest thing to do, because, you know, technically it is subject to RESPA, would be to send a lovely handwritten card, to call them personally and thank them, et cetera, maybe take them out to lunch and just catch up with them and see how they're doing, but not necessarily send them a gift card. You are free, however, to send gift cards or a cutting board or gifts like that to someone whom you've just assisted with a transaction. That's perfectly fine. But because they sent you, you know, their friend at the elementary school who's looking to buy a house and all that, technically it would fall under the
prohibition. But something that you throw away or you dispose of, like cookies, they eat that, it's gone.
I mean, are you going to have the CFPB in your backyard, you know, counting the cookies? No. But, you know, the technical answer under RESPA is that, you know, if it's a thing of value and it's for referrals, it's covered.
But sometimes people use the life is too short rationale.
Right. Yeah. there's...
And they're destroying the evidence.
That, I think that's the point. Of course, the other argument is that if it was really not, if they really weren't valuable, they wouldn't have eaten them.
If there's no other questions, I do have another.
Sure.
So what about the ones that say I donate $200 for every transaction I get, for every transaction I close? They use that as an incentive for people to refer business to you. Can you do that?
They can do that as long as they pick the charity. If they say, we'll pick... You can tell us the charity that you want us to donate to, and we'll do that. That comes a lot closer to being a problem. I think probably people are split about that, depending on how it works. But if they just say, we're going to contribute 10% of our commission to the Red Cross, That's perfectly legit. Well, even if they're the ones that are giving you the choice, that probably is okay too. But it's when you get to choose what the charity is, that then that kind of gets converted into a thing of value.
So if they choose, it's okay, or if I choose, it's okay.
If they choose, it's okay. If you choose it, you can choose among two things that they choose.
Okay.
But you can't say, well, I don't like Lab Rescue, but if you give it to Cocker Spaniel over here, I'm in.
Does anyone have any questions? I have one, just from the broker's perspective. I won't be selfish and ask it from the title company perspective. We talked about the employer-employee exemption and how it's not available for the independent contractor. And we start with the premise of it's illegal to give and receive a thing of value. What about the withholding of a thing of value? What if a broker, for example, has very strong relocation relationships,
yeah,
or invests heavily in platforms that give lots of referral sources, but then their agent is not supporting their affiliated venture, and they decide, well, you don't get the relocation referrals anymore because you're not meeting these goals that we have. How does RESPA look at that?
So it's two sides of the same coin a little bit. It's a little harder to prove what you've just said, but if there's a written policy that, you know, you have to agree, then, you know, then it's affirmative. If it, I think, really, I mean, there is some law out there, I think, that's not applicable, that you can withhold stuff, but too often when you withhold it, the implication is the opposite, that you have to do it in order to get the reward,
right,
and it becomes a violation. So
I wouldn't in good faith recommend it.
No, you shouldn't do it.
Anyone else before we let our guests go? Going once? Bueller? Jane, Jen, thank you so much for being here. We appreciate your time very, very much. Thank you. And thank you all for attending. Have a great day.